Good morning. Thank you all for coming to the Strengthening Health Institute. We're happy to host and welcome Mario Cusci, the oldest son of Meacham and Eileen Cusci. And also our good friend Steve Earle is here as well. So last night, Mario gave an introduction to the human dilemma, and he's going to continue with the subject today.
Yeah, thank you, Jenny. Thank you, Jenny. Thank you, all of you. Is Rich coming too?
He's supposed to be.
Okay.
That's right, he's not here.
I appreciate everybody being here. Danny and I, we went out earlier for coffee, and we were talking about how everything is just a movement of energy, and it's actually just a single movement of energy, and then through the body and through our way of perceiving, it's divided up into different patterns, and we create the individuals, etc., through our perceptions. And so then he said, whoever's here is no accident. You know, it's not. And which is absolutely true, because it's all a single movement. That we're all here together. So. And anyway, so I appreciate everybody being here, willing to listen to the insights that have been given to me. I don't know how else to put it. And what my intention is to continually focus on the way of seeing, which I talked about last night, which is as though we're looking together from a third-person perspective at ourselves as humans, and through that, and from that perspective, to be able to pierce through and see the way that we think has been programmed into us, and recognizing that to be able to move our attention and see what our true nature is. So what I'm offering, so the invitation is to see for yourselves what you already are. It's not about getting anywhere, it's not about some future event. As I had mentioned last night, I recognize time, future is something that's created in our mind. So it's about seeing everything exactly as they are now, and then being able to see everything, what's underneath that, what else is there, what else is there, just what is occurring moment by moment. And ultimately, with this recognition of one seeing for themselves their true nature comes with it a true freedom from fear and victim of circumstances, etc. So that's the purpose of today, and so so we'll look at it from a couple of different perspectives. I'll look at it from the perspective of what is our human design, what is the design of being human, and then I'll want to end with looking at what I call the evolutionary impulse, which I mentioned last night, and that how that's just a natural way the infinite, the universe unfolds. It's with this evolutionary impulse, and we as humans are an aspect, are designed with that natural evolutionary impulse, and it's actually, it's quite effortless. I mean, there could be pain associated with it, such as giving birth, for example. Not that I'm familiar with that. but it just happens. We can't, you know, just, you know, you can't resist, you know, it's just a natural process. And so that evolutionary impulse is also just a natural process. And the way we've been programmed, we unknowingly, we've been inhibiting this natural evolutionary impulse as human beings, and have not realized and recognized really what this amazing thing is to be human. Okay. I have this analogy of it's like a map. It's an onion. This onion is my map of what a human being is. So the center of our being is infinite. This heart represents infinite, unconditional love. And then the energy, the way that infinite energy moves from our center, infinite nature, and then out to the other layers. And then beyond the individual onion, out into the world, and then returns back. It's a two-way energy flow.
What did you say the heart represents?
The infinite. That's our core being. Beingness. It's the infinite. So, I'll start with. So the outer layer of the human is what I call the thinking layer. And so 90% of our attention is in the thinking layer. And with that, we're unconscious to our infinite nature. So this is the second layer is our feeling layer where we use our body. And when the thinking ends, then the attention can move into the layer of silence. So I'll stop there for the moment. Hello, Rich.
Hello.
Welcome.
Good to see you.
So, now, one thing to be clear is that this is a map that Norio came up with of this onion. And the map is not the territory. So don't take my word for it. You need to explore the territory yourself and see for yourself what is it that you see. These are the labels I came up with. And so this is the Norio map of a human being, but it turns out that all our life we spend in this outer layer where maps are created, in the thinking layer, and we stay in that, and we never explore what our real essence is.
So, what is the distinction between silence and the heart?
The silence, it's the silence is really, I don't know if it's actually a real layer so much as it's a, it becomes present when the thinking ends.
Mm-hmm.
And in the ending of thinking, the attention is, so then the absence of thought is silence. And then there's the awareness of the energy, which is then emanates from our core. And then what occurred for the Norio person was then was able to, with the ending of that thinking, move into and the recognition of the silence, effortlessly just relaxing and just moving in and seeing that there's energy, which everything is energy, actually. But this is the actual perception, being able to perceive energy. But this is all energy.
Mm-hmm.
And then light and vibration. The heart be the infinite. So, I saw this silence as like a field of, let's see, because what occurred for the Norio person as I'm driving and examining the world in the way that I described last night, finally seeing the totality of thinking and moved through this and seeing the silence. I was in this world of silence for 3 days. Before the ability to perceive energy. And the way that I describe it is the recognition of what thinking is and bringing all the unconscious to consciousness, which is we all created thinking, consciousness, as we tend to think of it today. There was the ending of thinking, and the feeling also is connected the feeling of the body, the energy moving through the body is feeling, and then as it moves into the brain becomes thinking. So there I was in the feeling world with the silence of the mind. So it was like the thinking world I saw as a house. I was in this house, in this room, in this house, and my entire world was in this room. But I was not aware that I was in a room. And as I explored what thinking is, or as it was revealed to me, and seeing the totality of thinking, I hit the walls. I was able then to perceive the walls of the room and recognize I was in a room. And with that recognition, there was a window. I could see into that, because I was in a room, I could see that there's something beyond my entire world, this world. And this is exactly what it felt like. And then, once I saw the window, I saw there was a door. A door out. I could look out the window and I could see this beautiful paradise, this garden. This amazing garden. And there's this door next to the window. And I walked out into this incredibly beautiful garden, this paradise. And that's what I call this world of feeling and silence, actually. It was simultaneously perceived. So here I luxuriated in this world, in this paradise, for 3 days. And on the fourth day, as I'm exploring this beautiful garden outside the house, and there's the house there, and now I'm out in this big garden, then I saw that there was a gate that led outside the garden. So there's this garden. And that's when that's perceiving the energy, that everything is energy, was that gate that took me outside the garden, this paradise. And with that, I passed through the gate, left this paradise, and I walked into this unknown, completely unknown world of just energy, and that's when, the moment I walked through that gate, I saw that I didn't exist. That's when I was hit with the cosmic dupa. It's like I walked through and I saw, oh, okay. So the idea that there is someone. Like, we go through life thinking there's someone that's experiencing life. It turns out that the experiencer and the experience is a single movement. They're not separate. It's a single movement of energy. So, the walking through the gate, so being in this beautiful garden, there was still a distinction between an experiencer and an experience. Even though there was no thinking, although it's the thinking which maintains our self-identity, there is still, energetically, somehow there is still a distinction between an experiencer and experience. So then, walking through the gate and seeing that, oh, I don't exist, then as I entered into this unknown, I turned around to look back, and I saw the gate and the garden, and the house was never there. It was no longer there. I saw that it had never been there. And so I turned around and just, I mean, there wasn't even an eye anymore. It was just this movement, and the movement brought me to the center of our core being. And so this is, and I saw that what was perceived that once I got to the core, I saw that all this energy is moving in different, breaking up into infinite patterns, and I could actually, or this, tune into any one of those frequencies or whatever, and just move into anywhere in the universe, into other dimensions. So, but this beingness, this that is called Morya now, physical form, there's already this pattern. So I just had to, and there was no doing it. It just was it was like just this energy which just returned me to this current form. And here I am, and here we are. You know? So it's I don't usually talk about all this, I just but it just seemed like it just came out. Because it's not something that's easy to describe. So the invitation, so as I said, this is just the map. This is the way that was perceived by this Norio character. And so the invitation is to explore this for yourselves. And so that's, you know, so you know, I appreciate the opportunity tonight to share this way of seeing that I stumbled upon with no particular reason.
So could I ask another couple of questions?
Oh yeah, sure.
So this whole, I'm not sure what to call it, but this whole thing about the house and the room in the house,
mm-hmm.
and the window and the door,
yeah.
mm-hmm. and then going into the garden and
yeah.
the gate. All of this occurred while you were in this state of silence.
The silence is ever present.
The silence is ever present.
Yes.
So
I didn't recognize the silence until I moved into the until the thinking ended. That's when I first perceived the silence.
Right.
You know, as an ocean, more like an ocean.
But you said that you were in the state of silence for 3 days.
Oh, yeah.
And it was on the fourth day
yeah.
you began perceiving everything as
yeah.
energy. So at what point did the what I'm sort of getting at, it seems it you know, you're sitting in you're driving your truck.
Right.
And you're in a state of silence.
Yeah, so
but you're going through this vision of a house and a room and a
yeah.
window and a door
yeah.
and so,
yeah.
so forth.
Yeah, exactly. It was all just a visceral feeling.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's it was really, it wasn't a state of silence, it was a state of sensation, feeling. You know,
yes.
there was still a perceived.
Yes.
So that's why I put the
yeah.
feeling
yeah.
there.
You weren't thinking about it in,
so, yeah,
in
there
words
was no
or
longer,
whatever.
No
was,
longer. The noise of thinking was no longer present. So it's really the realm of feeling and the sensation of, and the feeling was one of joy, and there was no just feeling, just this oneness with everything. And And I was, and the, what I, I mean, this was like completely, you know, unexpected. I like throughout all of this, I wasn't looking for anything. And that's one of the clues. And so the advantage I had was that I wasn't looking for anything, but now the invitation is for you to look for yourselves, but now unfortunately, what I'm telling you, color is what you...
Not really, just give us a direction.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, what about sleep? I mean, you didn't go without sleep for 3 days.
Oh, no, I slept, yeah, of course.
And then what if you were driving and there was a red light or an accident?
Yeah,
what
yeah so there was no disconnection from this, our current manifest world. I was fully present simultaneously in all of this. But interestingly enough, without the thought patterns interfering, I was much more present in the manifest world. And I was simultaneously feeling all of this. You know, so.
Have you been a meditator for years before this experience?
No, I never was into meditation. So, I mean, it's not something I would have considered meditation, but I now see that driving is really a form of meditation, or can be considered a form of meditation. Actually, anything can be considered a form of meditation.
So you would
can be arguing with our spouse and that could be a form of meditation.
You would wake up the next day and still be in this mental state or this
life? Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah, there's a something that I haven't had the chance to share with you yet is how this Noriel person was able to perceive all of this. There was a particular way that I was looking, and so I'm just describing in that looking what was revealed, because it turns out the way that we are looking, it's not fundamental to our true nature. It's been programmed into us since we were children, this way of perceiving. And it's directly creating our reality and creating our self-identity, what we are. And so the way that I began to see was a way that is natural, because that's the way we're born to see, but it's something that's been corrupted. So you had another question?
Yeah. Okay. I just had a comment. Last night, I think you made the distinction between feelings and emotions.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I thought that was very significant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we'll get into that a little more later on. So see, I was going to say one more thing about. Okay. So the map, as I said, this is just a map, a representation. It's not the territory.
Do you plan to recreate that again, Norio, or do you think it's once and done?
Oh,
you hope to recreate that experience?
Oh, it doesn't need to be recreated. That's just, you know, it's ever present. So it's so what I want to look at now Okay, so I'll go over the way of that I and the way of this way of seeing. What occurred for me is for this Norio person is that I was at a crossroads in my life, and I was looking at what is the next thing I'm going to do. I had lost my job, and I had sent out a few resumes. I had had an interview already at one company in Greensboro, North Carolina. And then, so I'm at home standing in the kitchen, looking out the window of my kitchen. And all of a sudden, I got this feeling, as I shared last night about feelings, that moved through the body, and I got that my life was not going to turn out. Okay. And with that recognition, there was a weight. I felt this weight lifted off my shoulder. This huge weight lifted off my shoulder. And it became very clear, oh, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back to driving a truck because it's something that I enjoy, something that I can make money and support the family, etc. So that recognition ended the living for a future. Like what we don't recognize is. So what we're looking at right now is, how is our mind programmed? In what way is our mind programmed when we're children? And so we're programmed as humans today to live for a future. Like, we're living as though in some future point, life is going to turn out. Eventually, I'll have enough money, I can do this. Eventually, I'll know enough, eventually I'll travel. You know, we have a bucket, you know, like a bucket list. A bucket list wouldn't exist without an idea of future. In the bucket list, climb Mount Everest, swim the English Channel, whatever is in our bucket list. You know, and we go through life checking them off. So I had this bucket list of things, which didn't include. I did have entertained the idea of climbing Mount Everest, but not swimming the English Channel. but I had a bucket list of things, you know, the kind of spouse that I would have, the kind of children, the kind of house, the kind of cars, plural, bicycles, plural, etc. So here we are, we're just born without this idea and sense of time or any sense of idea of future. When we're born, but this idea of living for a future is programmed into us. And as children, before that idea of future is programmed into us, we all know as children, that grown-ups are a little weird. If we remember when we were children, we look at grown-ups like they're somewhat crazy.
I remember thinking like that.
Yeah, exactly. I remember as a child, you know, I remember going to, you know, here I am, 6, 5 years old, looking at grown-ups and they're busy going to work and there's some guy reading a newspaper, you know, it's like, you know, it seemed like a crazy world, you know. With children, it's all magical. We're not living for a future. So there's some magic to being a child. And I remember thinking, I never want to grow up, you know, I don't want to grow up and be like that. You know? What, unbeknownst to me, with the recognition that life is not going to turn out, I mean, there was really this visceral feeling of this weight lifted off my shoulder. And the ending of living for that future, the returning to thinking as a child came back. And I remember the event when I was 13 years old, which anchored the Living for a Future, when I was sitting in the guidance counselor's office at school, and she was saying, okay, and I'm looking at going to high school. She says, okay, well, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know, you have to pick courses, you know,
prepare for
what I'm going to be when I grow up. I sat there and it just like, boom, I just saw, oh, you know, that was the turning point where I began to live for a future. So, you know, and of course, you know, I didn't see that there was anything weird or wrong about any of that. This is just, I saw was the process, you know, I didn't question it. So I'm thinking, you know, and I couldn't imagine it, but anyway, so we are all, unknowingly, we're all programmed, some of us much younger, you know. My parents gave me a great degree of latitude in my play, and there's always lots of people living around, so I could always escape and they'd never notice that I was gone, that I was missing, so. So it took me till I was 13 before I got hit with, you know, with the idea of living for, you know, having to live for a future. So. So with the recognition, life was not going to turn out. It ended that programmed way of living for a future. And what does that mean, living for a future? What that creates time. Future is time, right? And future is just a concept in actuality. It doesn't really exist, it's just an idea. And what is the future? What we project onto the future is only what is known. So and anything that's in the world of the known is the past. So all the future is a projection of the future, of the past. So, what occurs is that we begin to psychologically live as though we're you know, the donkey that had a carrot hanging out in front and a stick behind the donkey. Once we get caught up in this living for a future, we're now living, we become like that donkey with a stick behind us and a carrot in front of us. So that's one of the symptoms. Let's see, I'll write it down. Carrot and stick. Okay. So we're always trying to get away from pain and go after pleasure. That becomes our modus operandi. The other thing that occurs is that we become a doer. So we become human doings. Not human beings. Become human doings. Okay. The other thing is that we're now navigating life, attempting to achieve some future goal. And running away from failure. So we're looking through the lens of, hi Steve, how are you doing? And and we meet each other, and I'm thinking, is Steve going to underline our relationship? Is Steve going to help me with my goal, or is he going to interfere with my goal? Is he friend or foe? This is the way we begin operating in our relationships. So the way that I like to put it is that we now carry sword and shield. Walking with a sword and shield. Because we want to fight off failure, protect ourselves. So these are the unconscious ways that we are running. We don't realize it's not what we can perceive that it's like it's the unconscious which is running the show, and then it's the conscious mind which is then saying, coming up with the reason why we do this. Reasons are always created after the fact to justify our actions. We don't recognize that. When I was little, I recognized that. When I was going to school, and the teacher would ask, what's your excuse for being late? It's like, well, excuse. Oh, I have to have an excuse for being late. You know, if I'm late, I'm late. You know? I didn't realize that I could have a reason for being late. looking at adults like they're a little cuckoo. but then, of course, I grow up and I'm now caught up in that same paradigm reality as well. So if we look at our reality, how we show up today, we can see that it's all what I saw. What was revealed to me was that it's all been programmed, conditioned, programmed into us unknowingly by our parents and by our teachers and our society. It's the reality which is the prevailing fundamental reality that's been carried on for the last 10,000 years. And we don't recognize that this way of being is interfering with being in touch with our fundamental nature, which is ever present. So let's come up with some other ways that we show up. Anyone have any ideas?
About how we return to our infinite nature?
Oh, no, we won't look. Just what is our prevailing? How is the way we are showing up right now? How do we show up today? We look at the people out there, we look at ourselves. So I invite you to look at that. What is it that is mostly automatically occurring in our reality? Especially look at the way our thoughts are showing. What is
it? Well, I for one have been very angry lately because of the current political administration.
Uh-huh.
That's showing up a lot, and I never used to be an angry, resentful person, but I have a lot of anger leakage.
Okay, yeah. So there's a us versus them. So there's a me and a someone out there, the politicians out there.
Yeah, they're right? Doing terrible things.
Okay, so that's versus them is part of our reality. And when it doesn't meet our expectations and there's anger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm. So this is part of what fits into our current reality.
My current reality. Right?
Well, ours. You're speaking for everybody. You're speaking for humanity, actually. I mean, you have your individual specific thing that you're angry about, but we all have our way of seeing us versus them. And
some people, though, seem to have a more philosophical attitude, like, oh, well, I can't control that, so I'm not going to let it interfere with my life.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to have that type of an attitude, but lately, every day I see something that I find very upsetting, and,
mm-hmm.
you know, I feel is going to be harmful
mm-hmm.
to society and cause problems.
Okay, yeah.
You know.
Okay, so yeah, and that's perfect, because that's, so if we distill that down to what is it that's occurring, we remove the personal story and then just look at the mechanism. Because there's going to be people who take a different position than you on a particular topic. So what I'm looking at, it doesn't matter. So what I'm interested in looking at with all of you is not what the position is, but that we take positions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And that's what I'm really interested in looking at with all of you, is that we have positions. Okay? And none of this is right or wrong, and none of this has to be fixed. It's not about fixing anything. It's just about seeing things for what they are. So the way that we live, and this is where I'm saying that 90% of the way we're showing up is unconscious. There's only a very small percent, 10% of what we are, of how life is showing up is conscious, and 90% is unconscious. So these are the things that are unconscious, is that we have a position, okay? Not what the position is. We're aware of what the position is. I am this kind of person, that person's an idiot, whatever, you know. So, you know, I mean, so, and there's nothing wrong with that. The way in which, as I mentioned last night, is when I wake up in the morning, it no longer occurs to me that there's anything wrong, nothing wrong, it's completely absent now, and anything needs fixing. So wrong and fixing doesn't exist. It no longer exists for the Norio person. And so all of these I'm pointing out, not as if there's anything wrong with any of this, but just that this is the way that we are showing up. So that's great. So positions is an inherent part of the way.
Yeah, but I resent it because I feel like it's interfering with my personal happiness. So then I have resentment too.
Yeah, okay. Resentment. And what we don't recognize is when anything, because 90% of what's showing up is unconscious, we actually, what I recognize is we can't distinguish what's real and not real. And that's what's real is this, a fundamental nature is unconditional love. But we don't see that, because I'll get into why that is. Right now I just want to focus on how is it that we're showing up. So what you are describing is not personal to you. All of us are very familiar with everything you're saying. It might not be about the specific topic that the anger is arising from. But what it is that we're showing up with a position in opposition to something else.
Correct. And last night you said something. You said we are all responsible for the world.
Okay? Yeah.
So I'm thinking to myself, if I'm having all these negative feelings, this anger, this resentment, and all this other stuff, am I perhaps contributing to the problem, and how do I deal with that? Like, how do I, you know, recognize what I'm feeling is valid, but not project it and make things worse?
We'll look at all that. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a perfect question for today.
Yeah.
Perfect question, absolutely. And we'll look at all. Look at that.
It's really been a dilemma lately. So then, when I saw the human dilemma, I'm like, I should go to this.
So the human dilemma, Rich, is just to repeat for everyone, is that we don't know what we are, and we don't know that we don't know. That's the human, what I call the human dilemma.
Who we are.
Yeah, what we are. It's actually more appropriate, what we are. We don't know what we are, and we don't know that we don't know.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is about, it's not about giving you the answer today. It's about how to begin seeing what's actually happening, how to look to pierce the unconscious, to bring the unconscious to consciousness. So, okay. Anyone else? What else? How else are we showing up?
I think in my family it was severely frowned upon if you weren't always working and if you didn't make a lot of money, if you didn't have any hobbies, if everything had to do with work and doing. We didn't even have any concept of anything spiritual going on.
Do you mean that spirituality was frowned upon, or?
In some ways, everything was about money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah.
Just like if you weren't always doing something and working, you were kind of a slacker, you were lazy. And it was just all these negative things. If you just wanted to be for a while, that was like not happening.
Yeah. Okay, so I put down money.
And you didn't even volunteer. That wasn't because you weren't making money then.
Uh-huh.
So none of those things had any value.
Okay, so yeah. So you touched on one thing that we're human doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's how it felt like.
Right.
I had to be doing something.
Yeah, so we're human doing.
Yeah.
And another thing you touched on was money, which is a measure, which is comparison. So we show up programmed to compare.
Compete.
Competition, yes, absolutely. That's a good one, competition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, everything seems to be so competitive.
Yeah. Who swam a second faster? Who ran in a moment?
An analogy that comes to mind is my inner core is my hardware, and then I put on this software or application into my hard drive.
Yeah, that's why I use the word program. This is how we've been programmed. And as little children, we have no choice in this. It's not like when you're born into this world and say, oh, I think I'm going to be programmed this way. So through no fault of our own, individually, this is the way we are programmed. So, anything else?
Achievement and achievements and I think achievements is a good word. I think in terms of what we've achieved. and what our reputation is in the world. Accomplishments, yeah.
The word that came up for me was acquisition.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, accomplishment.
I think the biggest future tripping we're all programmed with is retirement. Like, you have to be ready for retirement.
So you have to grab
a certain amount of money
so
that you can not finally do anything.
Mm-hmm.
And then people are lost. A lot of people in retirement don't know what to do because they're so used to grabbing stuff. Mm-hmm. And
what were you going to say?
I was going to school.
Okay, school, yeah.
People say you go to school, and you have to do well in school. And you have to go to a good school so you can get a good job.
Yeah, because it has to come down.
So you can get into debt. So you can get into debt.
Yeah, exactly.
In the system.
Learns.
So you can know the government for your loan.
So this is a good. This is a good one. I like this one because it strikes me. You know, I have my own personal stories around this. So we're programmed to learn. Turns out that we don't learn anything. that the purpose of life is not learning anything.
And that we have to go to a certain school with a certain status to learn, that we can't just learn on our own.
Right, exactly. So I wanted to make a few comments about this. We can look at it a little more later, but anything that we study, anything we study is always about the past. Right? And the challenges facing humanity can't be addressed from the past. And yet, we're programmed to think that we can address it from the past. So, that's just an aside. For the Norio story, my mom, as I mentioned last night, when I was 5 years old, she told me to always trust my feelings and follow my feelings. She was 100% supportive in that. So anytime, she always knew when I was following my feelings, and my mother never questioned it. So when I was 15, I walked into high school. And as I went through the door, I stopped, and I'm looking at all the students arriving for school, and then I see the faculty running around. And I said, there's something wrong with this picture. I just felt there's something wrong with this. I turned around and I walked home. And I told my mother, I'm finished with school. I'm not going back. And she never asked me. She said, okay. She never asked me one question about it.
Which school was that? How old were you then?
I was 15.
15.
Yeah, in high school.
Did you ever go back, or did you?
The other thing about trusting the feelings is that there's never a doubt or question or regret associated with moving with the feeling. So that was it. I was done with it and haven't looked back. No regrets. Not like there's no thought that I should have, things would have been different if I did this. That's the end. So there's never been any kind of anything associated with it. So that, which is now another way that worry, regret.
Expectations.
Oh yeah, that's a great one. Expectations. Expectations, that's another good one. Yeah. So so these are ways that we're showing up. We have expectations, and so so we don't recognize that in all our institutions, in all our like marriage, we don't come into a marriage with a blank slate. We have all these unconscious expectations associated with marriage. And so, and and the irony is that no expectation ever works out, because expectations are all about the past, it's not about the present or the future. Or, you know, it's not about it's not about what's arising. So and here it goes back to a comparing. We're constantly comparing the expectation to what's arising. And then, because of the way we've been programmed, we think that what is arising is what's wrong. We don't recognize it's the expectation that we have of what's arising that is causing what we are upset or suffering. As I mentioned yesterday, whenever there's an upset shows up, we're never upset about what we think we're upset about. So this is an example. So the mechanism that occurs is as what is arising, we have a projected expectation on what is supposed to arise. So the upset is not about what's arising, it's about our expectation. And that's why I say, whenever there's an upset, we don't ever have to do anything about it. It's about seeing the mechanism, the totality of what is it that's happened, how is it that these unconscious things that are running me, how am I showing up? If we can see the totality of any of all this, you know, like the political situation or whatever, we can see how is it that we're showing up against what's actually arising. Is it that is the source of this, of the upset or the suffering? Before I saw this, I didn't know I was suffering. I had heard the term that life is about suffering, like a Buddhist type of thing, but I was never interested in religion, so I never paid any attention to it. But I realized, after I saw this, I realized I had been suffering my whole life. I just never called it suffering. The same way I saw that there had always been a fear, underlying fear. That's a good one, fear.
I always found that philosophy kind of upsetting, you know, like the Buddhist life is suffering. Yeah. I thought, well, yeah.
And yeah, exactly. I said, no, it's not about suffering. There's a lot of pleasure in it. Like,
yeah.
You know, and yeah, there's sometimes I suffer, you know. Of course, you know, I said, but it's not.
It seems rather grim, like a rather
yeah.
grim outlook.
Yeah, that's exactly the position I held. And so I didn't really pay attention to that. So, but now I recognize, looking at it from the perspective of nothing's wrong, nothing to fix, I see that suffering is not bad. So, oh yeah, never mind. So that's another, let's see, judging, that's a big one. We do that constantly, the way we're programmed. We try to stop judging. That's going to be one of the hard. If you try to stop judging, that's going to be. You'll find it's nearly impossible. It's in our programming. So, anything else?
I think TV commercials, your hair had to look a certain way, your makeup okay. had to be a certain way, you had to drive a certain kind of car to get the approval
yes.
of other people.
Image. Mm. Yeah.
You have to have the right image.
Right, exactly. Managing our image is definitely a big incident. I think we all are. and everything has to match our image. My girlfriend has to match the particular image, and what I dress, the car I drive, the job I have, etc. Image. Anything else?
Maybe there's a better word for it, but the perception that you should always be happy.
Yeah, I was thinking that because all along driving on the boulevard, there's all these signs that say smile and come to see us because we smile. It's like, you know, and one just said the word smile. And I thought to myself, like, no. I don't want to.
You don't feel like it right now, but for no reason.
I got a little resentful, like, don't tell me what.
Okay, so, yeah, so pursuit of happiness. So that's kind of like a subset of living for a future.
And expectations, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. So, but it's well worth noting, because that's something, that particular thing, pursuit of happiness, is really ingrained in our culture. And we look at that as something that's the purpose of my life, retirement. I'm going to be happy. So it's a future event. So that's a good one. I have to tell you, I could care less about being happy. But we'll talk about that later. I find it humorous now to look at this way that we are. And it's not bad, you know. Like I said, nothing wrong, nothing to fix. There's nothing wrong with any of this. We're just looking, we're studying humanity like we're ETs. Hey, look at this planet. Oh, what a paradise. Hey, look at these people on this planet. Wow, they're a little bit wacky, aren't they? So it's like that. So that's what, you know. But, you know, so as ETs, we're not going to, we may say, no, it's only a little wacky, but we won't, you know, we're not saying, oh, no, you shouldn't behave this way. No, you should be, you know, just studying objectively from a third person perspective. So, okay. Anything else?
Fitting in, like, you know, the feeling of wanting
okay.
to fit in socially.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a subset of comparison. But mm-hmm. yeah. But that's a good one. Fitting in. Or better yet, is belonging. Mm-hmm. There's a sense, there's this feeling of needing to belong, right? That's a good one. Anything else? How about, this is true for me, very true for me, is something missing. there's always an underlying sense of there's something missing in my life, right? I don't know, is that true for all of you or some of you? Now, you know, we all have different degrees of this. It's, you know, some more this. So, but this was prevalent for me. And there's always a sense of something's missing. You know. Anything else?
Like it's never enough. Like you do get to one right. thing, and then that's not yeah. enough. Now I have to go yeah. up higher.
Yeah. So it's like, you know, get one girlfriend, and then you first meet. It's the most amazing thing. It's like soulmates. And then after a while, it's like until
maybe I could do better.
Yeah. How did I get stuck with this person? I picked the wrong person. Okay. Another thing, which is related, is the sense of lack. Feeling of lack.
Not enough money, not enough.
Right, uh-huh. Yeah, not enough. Yeah, not enough stuff. Yeah, lack, not enough. Which is the contrast to what I wrote, acquisition. Mm-hmm. You know, that this lack, not enough, is money, automatic acquiring, achieving. Another one which is big for all of us, I would say, which I touched on yesterday, was sorrow. I didn't realize how big it was in my life, in the way that I showed up. Sorrow, this underlying sorrow, my existence, until I saw it. I started looking, and it was revealed.
Guilt and shame.
Yeah. Okay. That's great. Yeah. Guilt, shame. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, another thing that is prevalent in all of our lives as human beings, and I didn't know that this was prevalent in my life either until I saw it after being hit over the head with a cosmic 2x4, was that there's a seeking. Which is, you know, it's another way of describing acquisitions, accomplishments. I mean, this competition with this. But, like, because I was never interested in spirituality, I never saw that I was a seeker. Because seeking is always, tends to be used in the arena of the subject of spirituality. And so I realized that my pursuit of happiness, pursuit of money, pursuit of certain degree of notoriety, certain creature comforts and all that is seeking. It's very much a form of seeking.
Seems like so many people right now are like somehow seeking healing
yeah.
for
yeah.
something, and
yeah.
it's like
uh-huh. yeah.
that's think, like what most people are speaking right now, trying to heal some sorrow in their life.
So there's a sense of incompletion.
Right, looking outside.
I think it's kind of interesting how more and more people now like don't even talk to each other, and they're always looking at their phones or like iPad. And even like people when they travel somewhere, they're not even enjoying the time that they're spending traveling, because they're just taking pictures of themselves in front of all these things and then posting them on Facebook and being like, look what I was doing. And it's like you're not even enjoying the moment, because you're not even there. You're just looking at your iPad.
It's with our technology. I mean, technology is great, of course.
Yeah, I like it.
It's we use our technology as an extension of the way we're showing up.
Yeah. I think in some cases it's an addiction too.
Addiction. That's a good one.
And the whole selfie thing. Constantly events, everybody's like, wow.
But I think people feel like they're connected, but really it's like a lot of people feel lonely because other people aren't actually calling you. They're just telling you what they're doing.
I have Facebook friends, though, that I would love to meet them in person. Like, I've developed real genuine friendships with Facebook, so it is kind of a connecting thing.
Yeah, like I said, I love technology.
Yeah.
But what's interfacing with the technology is this. So technology is completely neutral. You know, it's like the technology we, most of the technology we use is used for weapons, for example. So in the same way, you know, any technology is...
Well, there's just less human contact then. Like you're contacting, but you're never like touching anyone or shaking their hand. You know, it's just all...
Yeah.
There's less actual physical contact.
Yes, that is true. It's... it becomes... The technology is being used to actually accentuate this. Unconscious, we don't recognize. You know, in an effort to connect with more people, we're actually becoming less connected.
Let's check this.
You know, because the joke is that the sense of disconnection is an illusion. And so the pursuit of wanting to connect accentuates the disconnection. And so that's what we use our technology for, if that makes sense.
I think technology, a lot of people say it actually has increased the time pressure. It was supposed to relieve our time pressure and give us more free time, but time has actually been, there's more time pressure now.
So we approach technology as a tool for acquiring, you know, to fulfill something missing, etc. And so because it has nothing to do with the technology, it has to do with the way we're programmed and showing up. It only, unbeknownst to us, the technology is increasing that.
I think it's used to polarize too. It's used to polarize. People in a way where employers, for instance, can make more money out of them by introducing this tech. Like, I used to go to a bank, and there used to be 12 or so people sitting around at desks, and you could go sit down and talk about any kind of an issue you were having. Then I went back to the same bank a few years later, and all it had was this one gray phone on a wall, and you had to call, and your problem would be handled that way. I don't like it. You know? I don't like this over...
there is no actual contact at all.
Exactly.
I mean, there is contact, but you never actually see a person.
Yeah, I mean, I like going in and having all these people that I could sit down and discuss my problem with face to face. I don't like the fact that technology is being used to eliminate jobs and to isolate people and to just like get more money without putting out enough money to you know, hire people to do the same thing.
Okay, so one of the things, you brought up a number of things that we've already put on here. But one of the things you mentioned is hierarchy.
Yeah.
You know, the boss is, you know, using the employees.
Yeah, there's too much greed in this country. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
anymore.
Yeah,
I don't
greed.
Like it.
Yeah. Greed, okay. So if we remove the judging and look at this from, nothing's wrong with any of this. It doesn't need to be fixed. Okay, this is.
I can't see.
Oh, no problem. Perfect. If you can't see it, then that's it. And
it bothers me.
And no. You know, 99.999% of us on the planet can't see it. You know, and so what today is about is to be able to begin seeing this. So hierarchy. We have gurus. Who are going to lead us to freedom, whatever. We have leaders that are going to lead us to freedom. Donald Trump.
Please, don't say
Trump.
That name.
So, So there's this hierarchy, you know. So which is another form of judging.
Yeah.
Comparing. So if we can look at it neutrally, okay, hey, this is the way we're showing up. And, you know, not good or bad, right or wrong. This is just, what we're just looking at. Oh, we're just looking at these humans. Oh, okay, they live from this hierarchy. Some people have all these things, and then there's all these millions of people who are starving to death on this planet. Interesting. Interesting. Yeah. Interesting creatures, these human beings. Okay. You know, this is the way that I was looking at all of this. Things were being revealed. This is how I was looking at it. So. Okay. Addictions, violence.
Very violent culture seems to be. Seems to be progressive. Like I was out last night, and people were just behaving very aggressively toward each other and yelling at each other. And
okay. Yeah.
The energy was very violent. The energy was violent. It was violent energy in the air.
Aggression, yeah. Okay, anything else? As we look through the microscope at humanity, what else showed, how else?
I guess traditions, like I see,
okay. We've
kind of lost all traditions, but certain groups like, you know, people I work with from certain cultures, I'm like, oh my gosh, they have traditions. They know what they're supposed to be doing at a certain time. And we seem to have lost all our traditions.
So is tradition a positive? Would you think of it as positive or negative? I am.
I guess it can be both. You know, they seem to have traditions, and I feel like the rest of us don't have those traditions.
Yeah.
Or we have some, but they're just barely there at this point.
So, yeah, at this point, you know, it was a trick question to ask you if it's good or bad. Because really, what really I invite you all to do is look at all this that none of it's bad. And that none of this needs to be fixed. We're just looking at this. Now we can say, okay, when we get tired, we just jump in and just set our coordinates for another galaxy within our spacecraft and off we go to someplace else. We got tired. Oh, like those humans, crazy. Okay, enough studying them. Okay. So okay.
One more. We've been dancing around it, so I guess we could put politics up there. Certainly has been your own.
Whatever politics is, yeah.
Well, I think right before you got here, you mentioned politics.
Politics is more the way we're interacting socially, and I'm looking to focus on, which is of course is valuable to look at, because how we're interacting with each other socially is a way of discovering how we are showing up as individuals. So the focus is, at this point, is looking at what's so for me, you know. Like every day, there was always, not every day, but if things got quiet, there was always something, a feeling of something missing. So I'd have to go get busy and do something. And it would cover up that sense of something missing. And go hop on my bicycle and go for it. Ride on my bicycle, whatever. Yes,
I can't. Feeling if you're not putting your time to good use.
This is who we are. Okay. Welcome to being human on planet Earth. Okay. Now here again, nothing wrong, nothing to fix. This is just what's up. And we never look at it. I never looked at it. But this is all revealed as I was driving my truck. There are two fundamental things which creates this, what we are, underlying this. Time and me. So, as a child, we adopt this me identity. And we learn to live for future. So this is the anchor. This is the prison which holds all of this. So once we adopt this me, welcome to paradise. Okay. And fortunately, nothing wrong, nothing to fix. You learn to love this mess. When you can see it for what it is, you love it. going to actually when it's going to appreciate it.
That's what you're going to teach us to do today, right?
Well, that's, well, no, that's something, you're on your own with that.
Okay.
So, any questions?
So, for children to drive, do you think they shouldn't go to school? Like, how do you protect their free nature?
That's interesting. Well, one thing about the way I was raised is I was never punished or disciplined. So in the same way I raised Joanne and I raised our children, we didn't never punish them or discipline them. And here again, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with the discipline or punishment. But, so the way my mother interacted with me, she always honored my feelings. And so that's the way I raise our children, Joanne and my children. But that doesn't mean that in the same way, they wanted to go to school, they wanted to go to college. So I'm supporting them in that. You know, I'm co-signing for their student loans and going into debt. I'm willingly doing that. They also know that I didn't go to school, and I always came. I thought, oh, if you don't want to go to school, no problem. But then they look at me and say, no, I don't want to turn out like him. I'm going to go to school.
So at 15, you dropped out of school completely?
Wow. Were you, what did you do with your time? Were you idle or were you content and doing things you really wanted to do?
I went and went out to the West Coast and lived out there with friends. I did a lot of bicycling. I went to Japan. That's when I met Steve. And check out another place. Well, formally met Steve. Actually ran into each other a couple of times before then. In 73. So I kind of just went with the flow, and then when I came back from Japan, because I like wheels, I just started driving a taxi. And then eventually I knew what I wanted to do was drive a truck, so at 25, started driving a truck. So to answer your question, the parents are the primary ones that program the children, but they're not the only ones. It's not exclusively them. And as the child gets older, it becomes less and less so. So it's basically out of our hands, so to speak. There's so much that's occurring. The doer, you know, there's always, anytime, looking for answers, where that's not the way we're showing up, answers. So we'll, as things are unfolding, because of all this that's going on unconsciously, we're looking for the answer. And which doesn't mean that information isn't useful. You know, there are all kinds of information is useful. It doesn't mean that there aren't teachers. Teachers aren't useful.
I mean, this makes me think there's every area I can think of modern life is being manipulated.
Okay.
The weather, the environment, biologically, thoughts, emotions, behavior, everything is being manipulated.
Manipulation, that's a great, yeah, thank you.
I thought of one other thing in school, like if you're just tiny and you have to say the Pledge of Allegiance, and I didn't even understand what I was saying.
Right.
But we were all forced to stand there, so that just programs you toward like military action eventually, because you have to protect your allegiance.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. Which goes into belonging.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're programmed
I used to think, who's
belong?
Richard Stantz, you know, who the Republic, what is it, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the Republic, I used to think it was of Richard Stantz.
Yeah, you don't even know what you're talking about, but
who's
you all
Richard
have to
Stantz?
That's your point.
And I never did find out, because I was kind of embarrassed to ask people, because I just, you know, everybody knew. Me, who Richard Stantz was.
So the programming, we're being programmed to belong.
Yeah, you're just so tiny and you're already like repeating this thing that you don't even know what they're talking about.
So in order to belong, we have to separate. We have to create groups that we then belong to.
Separation.
So right. So the this program belonging programming is there has to be separation that exists before there's belonging.
Do you think that's natural though, or do you think that's too divisive? Do you think
we're just looking at this like from the perspective of
and I'm judging.
I would say that it's not inherent. The way I would put it in line with what you just said is that I now don't consider this as inherent to our nature. It's something that we're programmed with once we're born. It doesn't, when the baby is born, the baby isn't born with any of this. You know, so it's not inherent in the nature of being human, but then the baby is brought and programmed with these things. So it's not right or wrong, good or bad. This is just the way we've been programmed. The baby, the child, has no choice. Doesn't know, you know, like I'm speaking English, I had no choice to learn and speak English. We have no choice in this program. You know, the baby doesn't sit there and say, oh, let it be programmed. So the prison that's maintaining all this is me and time. The first recognition I had was that as I'm driving, and looking at what does it mean to be human. That's the question that.
And this is too.
Was the underlying question I was asking myself.
There's a small one first.
And I'm not saying that this is
this one? Well,
the question to ask. This is what showed up for you. So that's the question I was asking as I was driving, and as I described last night, that as I was asking that, I began to, because I was looking from the perspective, nothing wrong, nothing needs to be fixed, and asking this question, that I started seeing these things. The big thing for me was sorrow, and then time was the next big thing that I saw as I was watching all this. So, and then eventually the me. We'll look at that more. Any other more questions?
Did you feel a lot of pressure from being Michio and not being the son that you were supposed to be, like, a perfect representative of everything?
Well, actually, I never felt that from them so much. A little bit from my dad. You know, like my dad would, you know, tell him, oh, I want to race bicycles. And he said, oh, yeah, fine, good, very good, very good, very good. As I got older, you know, and I tell him what I wanted to do, then, you know, sometimes he'll throw in, eventually you will come to macrobiotics. Or so a little bit. A little bit, there was some pressure from my dad, but never from my mother. I shouldn't say never, but, you know, it's just, the pressure comes from within, actually, not from the exterior.
Right.
You know, the pressure is because I am a human doing, really. So can we all see this? You know, it's not good or bad. Not a bad person. this is our wonderful human doingness. And how are we doing? Should we take a little break here?
Sure.
Yeah. I can get a glass of water. And,
so we go till 12:30 and then it's lunch.
I was thinking maybe your term macro community, right?
I go back ways.
I thought maybe I'd recognize your name.
I was really prominent in macrobiotics. I'm known as a macrobiotic teacher.